The next item of business is topical questions, and in order to get in as many people as possible, I'd be grateful for short and succinct questions and responses. And at question number one, I call Stephen Kerr.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to the ruling of the Scottish Information Commissioner that it should release legal advice that it received regarding a second independence referendum.
Cabinet Secretary Angus Robertson.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. We've received the decision from the Scottish Information Commissioner and are considering its terms. We will respond within the deadlines set by the Commissioner. There is a long-standing convention observed by UK governments and Scottish governments that government does not disclose legal advice, including whether law officers have or have not advised on any matter except in exceptional circumstances. The content of any such advice is confidential and subject to legal professional privilege. This ensures that full and frank legal advice can be given.
Stephen Kerr.
Yesterday, the First Minister refused to commit to the Government actually publishing the legal advice in full, despite the ruling of the Scottish Information Commissioner. And can the Cabinet Secretary confirm that the Government will publish this advice in full, as recommended by the Information Commissioner, or are they intending to go to court to prevent this advice from being made available to public scrutiny?
Cabinet Secretary.
As I've said, we've received the decision from the Scottish Information Commissioner and we're considering its terms. Any departure from the convention is a significant thing. Legal professional privilege and the Law Officers Convention protect legal advice given to all governments in these islands. This is a significant ruling by the Commissioner, and given that, we want to consider it carefully. We'll respond within the deadlines set by the Commissioner.
Stephen Kerr.
I think that was the answer we had some moments ago. The Scottish Government civil servants are secretly working on a referendum prospectus and now learn that public money may be used to cover up legal advice on a second referendum. This government is spending hundreds of thousands of pounds, maybe millions, on its referendum obsession and refusing to allow any of it to be open to public scrutiny. Does the minister recognise that all of this is an insult to Scottish taxpayers who are being forced to pay for secret preparations for a referendum next year they do not want?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, the first thing I'd observe to that political speech that we had at the end, rather than a question, was reflecting on the fact that this Parliament has been elected with a majority of members to deliver a referendum during this term. A fact that Mr. Kerr finds very difficult to respect or even acknowledge. It is entirely appropriate for the government to pursue the policies it was elected to do, and in terms of the legal advice, pursuing it in line with the precedent of both UK and Scottish governments. We will reply to the Information Commissioner's findings, and we will do so in due course.
Julian Martin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. When a political party is voted into government on a manifesto commitment to hold an independence referendum, not once, but twice since 2014, can it be judged that this is the will of the people and that it's their democratic right to see it fulfilled?
Yeah, I think, Cabinet Secretary, the substantive question was about the response to the ruling of the Scottish Information Commissioner. So I will move on to take Sarah Boyack.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. There is now a clear pattern of behaviour under this SNP government. Advice and documents which have a significant impact on the government's priorities are hidden from members of this Parliament and from the people of Scotland, whether it's ferries, the ECHR or the Constitution. Does the Cabinet Secretary not agree that the people of Scotland, regardless of their views, have a right to see this legal advice to enhance public debate in line with the Information Commissioner's ruling? And will he not make arrangements for the immediate publication of this legal advice, given its significance to the whole of the population of Scotland? And what will he do in his work with MSPs to improve the transparency of information?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I think, Presiding Officer, I'm here specifically to answer questions in relation to the Information Commissioner and his ruling. I can but repeat what I have said to colleagues already, which is it's a significant ruling, it's one that must be considered in the round, and we will reply to that in good time within the deadlines that have been set. What I find quite interesting about the tone so far, both from the Labour Party and the Scottish Conservative Party, is that there seems to be a willingness to depart from the established custom and practice in relation to legal advice. And it might be helpful in the weeks ahead for both parties to clarify their position on whether they think that government ministers in Scotland or indeed the UK should be able to receive information from their legal advisers with the confidence that has been custom and practice, not just for years, but for decades.
Mm-hmm. Colette Stevenson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Given the pro-independence SNP and Greens won a majority of seats in the 2021 election, does the Scottish Government believe that democratic decision should be respected and that people of Scotland have the right to choose their own future, the choice to become a fairer, greener, independent European country?
Thank you. I will just remind members that it is essential that supplementary questions refer to the substantive question on the paper, and we will therefore move to question number two, Faisal Chowdhury.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what measure it is putting in place to ensure that Ukrainian families understand the condition of its super-sponsorer scheme.
Minister Neil Gray.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I thank Faisal Chowdhury for his question. The Scottish Government is providing funding to Just Right Scotland, for its confidential legal advice line for Ukrainians in Scotland. This includes advice about our super sponsor scheme. As soon as the UK, anyone naming our national contact centre sends that person a welcome message in Ukrainian and Russian, and this includes a free phone international contact number for further advice. Once in the country, the Scottish Refugee Council's Integration Service, funded by the Scottish Government, can give further advice, from registering for a GP to enrolling their children in school. And to raise awareness of the Scotland's super sponsor scheme, my officials have been working closely with international organisations, NGOs such as UNHCR, as well as the Polish, Romanian and Moldovan authorities, to provide clear in-country information to explain how the scheme works and why it offers enhanced protection. I myself met with the Ukrainian MP Lesia Vasilenko last week and discussed Scotland's offer, and I hope to visit Poland in the coming weeks.
Mr Chowdhury, there was a little break-up in the Minister's response, but are you content that you've heard enough? Thank you. Mr Faisal Chowdhury.
I would like to thank the Minister for that answer. Last week, my colleague Sarah Boyack invited Scott Host, a group of representing hosts of Ukraine refugees, to meet members. They have produced a very thoughtful analysis of the good and the bad aspects of the scheme. A pressing issue that they highlighted was that the welcome desk at Glasgow and Edinburgh Airport, intended to welcome Ukrainians arriving into the scheme, have frequently been left unstaffed during normal working hours. This has meant that refugees, sometimes with low level of English literacy, have been left to fend for themselves on arrival, particularly when travelling on to other parts of the country. How can the Scottish Government ensure that this very important initial part of any warm Scott welcome is available to refugees?
Minister.
I thank Faisal Chowdhury for that question. My officials have been working closely with Gary Gray and Scott Host to understand the concerns that they have, and also to respond to some of the ideas and other suggestions that have been made. In terms of the welcome at our airports, I have received no reports of any issues at Edinburgh Airport. The one report that I received regards Glasgow Airport was acted upon very swiftly, both by the airport, by Renfrewshire Council, and also Glasgow City Council, and volunteer workers from the Ukrainian community, to ensure that the Scottish Refugee Council and others on the ground were able to ensure the staffing of that welcome desk could be carried out as efficiently as possible. And my understanding is that there have been no further reports of anyone arriving having not received access to that desk. I'll continue to monitor that situation because, obviously, ensuring that people, when they first arrive in the country, get access to information that is clear and consistent is of the utmost importance to us all.
Faisal Chowdhury.
Thank you very much for that answer. Another point raised by the Scot host was that the hosting of refugees is not an event. It is a process, and there will be inevitably be a longer-term needs for both the refugees themselves and their hosts, which will need addressing. How will the Scottish Government amend its approach in response to ongoing challenges with our Syria and Afghan refugees? Refugees are the same regardless of where they are from.
Minister.
I would absolutely concur with that last point, and the Scottish Government's response to unfolding situations around the world have been consistent that we want to provide a place of sanctuary and support here in Scotland, regardless of where that person is arriving from. And we have a very good system in place, having a true partnership through the Syrian scheme that we're looking to replicate with all 32 local authorities and our third sector partners for the Ukrainian scheme. There have been well-documented issues with the Afghan scheme, which operated on a different approach, where it wasn't a true partnership between UK government, Scottish local authorities. And we're looking to see what can be done to provide as much assistance as possible to Afghan refugees present here who are still looking for further support.
Co-Cap Stewart.
Thank you. The harrowing scenes coming out of Ukraine have quite rightly prompted action on a scale not seen before, including the change in legislation in the UK to enable Ukrainian refugees to be able to access support and work after fleeing such horrors. It is my sincere hope that the outcome of this change in the way that we treat all those seeking refuge, regardless of where that may be. Can I therefore ask the Minister what representations the Scottish Government has made to the UK Government to lift no recourse to public funds and any employment restrictions for all asylum seekers and refugees arriving in Scotland? And would the Minister agree that if they are not willing to implement such a change, then Scotland should be given the powers to enable asylum seekers to live with dignity?
Minister.
Co-Cap Stewart for that question, which she is absolutely right and completely concur, particularly with her sentiments in the last part of her question. I met with Lord Harrington, my ministerial equivalent at Westminster, and also Kevin Foster, the minister with responsibility for immigration in the Commons last week, where I raised areas such as this, but also my concern around the to ensure that we are communicating effectively across the UK on safeguarding and ensuring that people arriving from Ukraine know that there is the safest route is through Scotland, where there is a statutory matching service operated by the Scottish Government and Scottish local authorities, and that there is no need for private matching, which is one of the major concerns I have around the informal social media matching, often well-intentioned by people who are carrying it out, but obviously pose significant risks. And I called on the UK Government to implement a UK-wide super sponsor scheme to ensure that we can have a substantial, more substantial safeguarding protections put in place across the UK.
Donald Cameron.
Thank you. Those of us who attended the Scot host's briefing last Thursday, hosted by Sarah Boyack, would have been struck by the comments about a perceived lack of coordination amongst local authorities. What is the Scottish Government doing to ensure councils across Scotland and COSLA are cooperating, learning from each other and working with each other to ensure those applying to the super sponsor scheme can understand it better?
Minister.
I thank Donald Cameron for that question. He should be reassured, as should Scott Host, that I have regular meetings with COSLA and with local authorities, as he would have expected. And we have issued guidance to all local authorities to ensure that that's published on the Scottish Government website for everyone to see, to ensure that there is a consistency in application, both in terms of what people should expect when they're arriving, but also in terms of what the longer term support arrangements should be thereafter. And again, I say to Donald Cameron, as I said to Faisal Chowdhury, my officials have been meeting with Gary Gray and Scott Host, and the concerns and the suggestions that have been raised are being considered.
Thank you. Question number three, Emma Roddick.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what assessment it has made of the potential impact on households and businesses in Scotland of the National Grid's locational pricing system, in light of Scottish Renewables' reported assessment that transmission network use of system charges make projects in Scotland almost 20% more expensive than equivalent projects in the south of England.
Cabinet Secretary Michael Matheson.
Officer, this is a reserved issue to the Westminster Parliament, and any changes to pricing would require policy and legislative changes which are not within the control of National Grid. However, I am deeply concerned by the proposal to move to a locational pricing system and the lack of consideration this work has given to Scottish Government targets. In a net zero world, it is counterproductive in the extreme to care more about where generation is situated rather than what type of generation it is. It's vital that we deliver net zero at lowest cost to consumers and do so in a way that does not penalise developers for taking forward projects in the best locations.
Emma Roddick.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. Scotland is a net exporter of energy. We export 18 times more to England than we receive back, and yet there are warnings that the National Grid's new locational pricing system could create a postcode pricing system in the middle of a cost of living crisis. Is the Cabinet Secretary concerned that these plans could penalise Scotland's renewable sector at a time where it has the ambition to be the green energy capital of Europe?
Cabinet Secretary.
Officer, at this particular time, when there is a desire to deliver energy security and to do so in a way which is compatible with achieving net zero, it is critical that we have a charging regime that does not start to act as a constraint on the way in which developments can be taken forward. We know that the existing charging scheme acts as a disincentive to investments here in Scotland, and it makes some developments less competitive with their similar projects in other parts of the UK. Therefore, any tweaking of the system, which is potentially what this change would involve, again could act as a further disincentive to projects being developed here in Scotland, and in my view would be absolutely counterproductive to making sure that we reduce energy costs at the same time as meeting our net zero targets.
Emma Roddick.
Thank you. Given that we are in the midst of the cost of living crisis and many households, particularly in my region of the Highlands and Islands, are already struggling, does the Cabinet Secretary agree that the UK Government, which holds the key levers of power on this issue, must urgently step up and do more to help those hardest hit by energy grid charges?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, Presiding Officer, we know that renewable energy, wind energy in particular, is one of the lowest cost forms of electricity that can be produced, alongside the wider benefits that can come from it, alongside areas such as hydrogen. And we need to capitalise on that and maximise those potential areas of development. That's exactly what the Scottish Government is seeking to do, and it's important that regulators and the UK Government do not introduce any scheme that will act as a constraint on maximising these potential opportunities here in Scotland. I can assure the member that we will continue to press this issue on the UK Government. I have already discussed the issue with the National Grid Chief Executive to express our concerns about the proposal and the lack of consultation and engagement with the Scottish Government, given the direct impact that this could have on our net zero targets in energy policy. And I can assure members across the Chamber that we will do everything we can to ensure that Scottish renewable energy projects receive the level playing field that they deserve for developments being taken forward in the same way that projects across the rest of the UK are provided with.
Horace Golden.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. In terms of Tenneos charging, the SNP have consistently argued that Scottish consumers should pay more in order to subsidise energy generators, primarily multinational companies. The latest targeted charging review of transmission demand residual partially addresses this aspect, meaning that every Scottish consumer will pay more. The floor approach suggested to the forward-looking charge would result in an overall decrease in Tenneos charges for typical domestic customers, apart from those in Scotland. For North Scotland in particular, Ofgem notes that charges will increase compared with current charges, given the assistance for areas with high electricity distribution costs. I've asked this before, but does the Cabinet Secretary agree with the flooring the forward-looking charge at zero, yes or no?
Cabinet Secretary.
Yes, sir. It's interesting listening to Maurice Golden quite literally set out the utter failure of the UK Government to address the transmission charging costs regime that we have in the UK, which is penalising Scottish-based projects and has been penalising them for an extended period of time. There is no doubt that there is no reason why you can, doesn't understand that the industry have been complaining about this issue for many, many years. And then what do we get from the National Grid? A proposed tweaking of the system to appear as though they are dealing with the issue that potentially could make it even more difficult for Scottish-based projects. What we need is we need a process which ensures that the charging regime is not based on location, it is based on the type of energy that it is producing. And that's why the systematic failure of the UK Government to address this issue over an extended period of time has continued to disadvantage projects here in Scotland, and also adding in a bit of nuclear, pushing up the cost for taxpayers right across the country and paying more for their energy costs as a result.
Thank you. That concludes topical questions. The next item of business is a debate on motion 4236 in the name of Ash Regan on Fireworks and Pyrotechnic Articles Scotland Bill. I'll allow a moment for members to move seats.